So in this film, we're finally going to write out the formal definition of what we mean by the limit of f of x as x tends towards a is equal to l. This now, of course, is the two-sided limit. So let me do one intermediate intuitive step here before I write out the definition, which is analog to what we did for limits of sequences. So what we want the definition to capture is that x close to a implies f of x close to l. So when x tends towards a, f of x should tend toward l. And now comes the question, how close? Well, arbitrary close. And how close here? Well, sufficiently close. So when x gets sufficiently close to a, or rather, to make f of x arbitrarily close to l, we can do this by making x sufficiently close to l. Okay, how can we formulate this? Well, we use our epsilon to be the arbitrary part. And now we want something small to be the sufficient part. So for sequences, we did capital N. Here we'll do delta. So this will be the sufficient part. Okay, so for every epsilon, there exists a delta so that this holds. But what is it that's supposed to hold? Well, f of x close to L, that means the distance of f of x to L should be small. So this means f of x minus L should be small, right? How small? Well, arbitrarily small. And here, x close to a, what should this mean? Well, this means x minus a, small. Well, how small? Sufficiently. So what we want here is that for every epsilon, which is going to be our challenge here, there should be a delta, which tells us how small we need to make this, such that for every x in the domain of our function f, we have, now comes the implication, x minus a delta small implies the distance between f of x and l, epsilon small. So this is the arbitrary challenge, and this is the sufficient answer. And here's one detail we need to point out. It's that the definition of the limit should not depend on the value of f at a. So if x is not defined at a, we're happy. But if it is, we need here to state that x should never be equal to a. You could also do this by putting this inequality here, then you can take away this. But usually it's better just to state this thing here. So these two things should imply that. And of course here, for this to make sense, I need to be able to find x as delta close to a. If not, this thing here would be empty. So logically, that's not a huge problem. But in order to keep things tidy, I put here first, assume f defined unpunctured neighborhood of x equals a. Then this statement here is exactly what I mean by this, by definition. So if I want to prove that such a thing holds, this is what I use. Now, let's take this definition out for a spin. So, example, prove that lim, or use the epsilon delta definition here to prove that as x tends to 2, 2x minus 1 tends to 3. The proof is more or less as we saw for sequences. So first thing we do is let epsilon be arbitrary. And then we say here fixed but unknown. And what we need to do is study this expression here, okay? And figure out for which x does this hold. And when we figure this out, there will be a natural candidate for delta popping up. So we compute just as for these sequences. So f of x is now 2x minus 1. L is 3, and we want to get this less than epsilon. But just as for sequences, we should think of this thing here in terms of some chain of equalities and inequalities, and we only insert epsilon at the very last stage. So we begin by simplifying. So we have now 2x minus 4. We can factor out to 2, and then we have x minus 2 here. And this is all very good, because what type of inequality do I have up here? What is it really saying here? Well, I'm tending towards 2, so here I'm getting a 2, right? So here I want to put my condition for when this is small in terms of how close x is to 2. and now x minus 2 appeared. Yay. And in fact, since this difference here is proportional to x minus 2, then of course putting x minus 2 small will put this small. Now, how small do I need to get it? Well, then I can ask, because now I have a quite simple expression, and now I can impose my epsilon condition, and then I can solve for this guy here. That's the point. Just as for sequences, we solved for little n, and now we solve for this expression. And whatever was on the other side when we solve for little n, that would be our capital N. And whatever is going to be on the other side when we solve for this, well, that's basically going to be our delta. So let's see how that works. I get now this thing here. And then I know when this thing is smaller than this, then this thing is smaller than this, which is what I needed to get. And then this thing is my choice of delta. And of course, this depends on the epsilon. It's a delta response, just like the n was a response. So this is a function of epsilon. And then we can now give ourselves some numerical challenges. So if epsilon is equal to 1, my restriction here would be that this should be smaller than 1/2. Okay. And then we see if this thing here is smaller than 1/2, I get 2 times 1/2, which is 1. And we can also now look at this visually. So here I've put my function 2x minus 1. And now here I put this point above 2, which puts me at height 3. And then now I can do a challenge here. So if I do a challenge of 1, that means going a distance 1 to either side. We can see how this works. So if I'm challenging myself, let's do it here by an epsilon, then I can open this inequality up here. I can do this and this. And then I see by adding L to every side, I'm getting this thing here. So having f of x minus L less than epsilon in absolute value is the same as f of x being smaller than L plus epsilon and bigger than L minus epsilon, it should say here. And in particular, if I do epsilon equals to 1, I'll have here L minus 1 and L plus 1. So my limit here was supposed to be 3. So when I choose epsilon 1, I'm getting from 2 up to 4. That's exactly what I'm having here, from 2 up to 4. And then I need to figure out some delta response. What does that mean? Well, here, notice I'm putting a big response. So this means I'm saying I can go 1 to this side, and I can go 1 to that side. Okay, so I'm going 1 like this and 1 like that. What does that mean? Well, it means I'm now, when I'm letting x be go from 1 to 3, I'm getting y values starting here, going all the way up here. Are these values satisfying this double inequality? Well, yes, if all of these orange values fall within the green zone, which they don't. Meaning I have to take a smaller delta. And how small does it have to be before all the orange y values fall within the green zone? Well, like this. So how far do I go here now? Well, a distance of 1/2. And how far do I go here? A distance of 1/2. So if I choose delta to be 1/2, meaning I'm allowed to go a distance of 1/2 to each side, then all my orange y values, which are the y values corresponding to how far I'm going to the right and left here, will fall within the green zone. That is, the y values will be of a distance at most 1 from where I want it to be ideally, at 3. And what does this have to do with the limit? Well, the point is that by making epsilon smaller and smaller and smaller, I here have a formula telling me how small I should do the delta in order to win, right? And I know, no matter how small epsilon I'm challenged with, I can always choose a good delta by taking 1/2 of the epsilon I'm challenged with. So here I'm challenging myself with epsilon being 1/2. You see I'm going up 1/2 and down 1/2. And then from this formula, I know that the proper answer is 1/4. And you can see here, I'm going 1/4 to the sides, and then I win. And that's basically it.